Right now on the Comcast Business Hotline, as promised, my man Rick Morris from the FDH Lounge in Cleveland has a national radio show. Hello, Rick. How you doing today, my friend?
Joe, I'm doing actually pretty good. It's been interesting listening to your callers. It's the balm I need on a day like this, listening to your callers drinking the narrative moonshine.
They are, aren't they?
Yeah.
Especially Lee. He's always got something flowing. But what's the latest on LeBron? What are you hearing? I know they tanked last night and they're out, and LeBron doesn't look happy with his supporting cast. But, you know, what are you hearing on LeBron? What's the latest?
Oh, the same thing everybody else is. As we're looking ahead here, the things that are interesting, and again, there are a few better sources about all things LeBron historically, and there really never have been any better sources than Brian Windhorst. And one of the things that he is saying, because he's followed him longer than just about anybody, is that LeBron is not going to back away from wanting the Supermax. So you talk about threading a needle as far as his options going forward. Getting the Supermax plus being in a place that can really win, and he's not going to be in a place where anybody else is going to take a haircut either, like Chris Paul. So I've been saying all along there aren't a lot of great options, but you asked me what I thought about going into Game 7 with the Eastern Conference Finals, and I said I thought it meant something because mostly it would look bad if the Cavs didn't win. Well, the Cavs won that game, but it doesn't look good for the Cavs the way that it played out against Golden State, although it's interesting that LeBron himself pointed out how games 1 and 3 were games that they let slip away. So the narrative that Golden State is unbeatable right now, they're mostly unbeatable. But yeah, we'd be looking at things a little differently if game 1 had gone the way that it looked like it was going to anyway.
Yeah. How frustrated, you know, do you think LeBron is? I mean, he's trying to be a good soldier and a good teammate. He did mention when he was asked about being criticized the other day, well, how much more can I carry my teammates? And then we saw the George Hill, J.R. Smith debacle in game 1. After he drops 51. I mean, he just looks frustrated with his supporting cast. I know a while ago you thought he might be leaning towards staying in Cleveland. Do you still believe that?
No, I think the Cavs have slipped back in the pack. I had thought all along it was maybe about a 51% chance, again, because of the whole Supermax narrative. Only the Cavs can give it to them. And interestingly enough, that puts them in somewhat of kind of a veto kind of a situation. For example, if LeBron doesn't back off on that, and if Chris Paul doesn't back off on that, I don't see a path to Houston. Because the Cavalier franchise, say what you will about them, and Dan Gilbert has done a number of things wrong the last couple of years, not least of which firing an excellent general manager that could be in your parts not too long from now. But he's done some things wrong, but you look at the number 8 pick in the draft here, which should be a very, very good player. They're prioritizing the future with or without LeBron. This team is not going to take back bad contracts from Houston. That's the only way that happens. This isn't a charity game at this point here. The Cavs will work with a team if it comes to that, if they can get back something good. Say Brandon Ingram from L.A., say maybe buying low on Fultz from you guys. You're not going to really need them. You're going to have too many ball handlers as it is if it's LeBron and Simmons,
sure, as
I keep maintaining. So this team is in an interesting spot regardless. But as far as the number one option narrowly over a number of other teams, no, I wouldn't say that. They might be 3 or 4 at this point. But I don't know who the teams ahead of them are. There just aren't a lot of great options out there. I've never understood why LeBron seems to have dismissed the Clippers altogether. You want a clean slate. Chris Paul could go back there. He could go there. They have cap room. For whatever reason, I guess it's a grudge over the fact they were once owned by Donald Sterling. But I've never understood the Clippers being off the board for LeBron because they make more sense than just about anybody on paper.
Rick Morris on the Comcast Business Hotline. Rick, you alluded to the former GM of the Cavaliers, David Griffin. I would have hired him like 7 days ago. How much do you think if he was the Sixers GM, how much would that maybe help the Sixers' chances of landing LeBron?
Well, here's the thing. I've said this for a long time. David Griffin is a genius. And LeBron knows that he's a genius because he actually tweeted that out the night that Griff was fired, basically, you know, a shot at Dan Gilbert, deservedly so, that even if nobody else appreciated you, I did. Because people look at the deal for the last couple of years, and there have been a lot of smart marks in the media and the fan bases out there. How can you give up number one picks for Timothy Mozgov? You know, the team won a championship under impossible cap circumstances. The price of having LeBron is that you always have impossible cap circumstances. And people look at, again, the Tristan Thompson and the J.R. Smith contracts. Well, look, that was LeBron putting his thumb on the scale for fellow Rich Paul clients there. That's basically what that was. LeBron was, and this is once again the whole thing of max contract versus what's best for the team. And that's what makes it such an interesting thing going forward here, because LeBron, the last couple of years, you know, he had a chance a couple of times to say to those guys, hey, maybe take one for the team here to help keep it together.
Sure.
Griff gets saddled for that. People look at, oh, well, look at the contract situation. I look at all the things Griff was able to make happen. The deals, pulling the rabbit out of the hat, the players he could get here. People were amazed when he made it happen with getting Kyle Korver here, which, unfortunately, the one team in the league Kyle Korver doesn't match up well with is Golden State, as we've seen. But, you know, be that as it may, Griff is a genius. With or without LeBron, you guys will be lucky to have David Griffin. No question about it.
Yeah, that's what I said. The worst-case scenario is you still have a very good GM in place. And right now they don't have a GM in place. They have an interim GM and head coach Brett Brown. The instability of the team right now and what happened with Brian Colangelo, if it takes a while to put a GM in place and it's not David Griffin, how much does that weigh against the Sixers?
I don't think that much. One of the things that I do think, and again, LeBron is going to be looking at the whole matrix of options here, and as I've been thinking about Philadelphia, one of the things is, and I don't know if LeBron, who knows in terms of his exact thought process, I'm going to guess that he's not quite the fanatical student of the odds that I am, but I look at it like LeBron's already played with one guy, Zydrunas Ilgauskas, who really kind of beat the odds in terms of the injury thing during his career. Does LeBron think he's going to be playing with two guys that could beat the odds? Because Embiid, so far, basically, kind of, sort of, is doing it at this point. But that's one of the things, too. I know that Embiid's health has got to be something that LeBron is going to be considering as it relates to Philadelphia, because why wouldn't he? Because if he goes there and Embiid is, for whatever reason, not part of the picture, I think you'd have to agree that changes everything.
Rick Morris on the Comcast Business Hotline. Before I let you go, bro, I got to ask you, what do you think the fans' reaction in Cleveland will be if he rolls?
Oh, it's going to be much milder than last time because, again, all 4 years he was here, the team made the NBA Finals, won championship. And, again, there's a price to be paid in terms of what the salary cap looks like at the end, if this is the end of him being here. There was unfinished business in 2010. This time around, there wouldn't be. I'm actually unhappy at the amount of acceptance that there is out there for it. If you're a real Cavs fan, you want to see him back here. So I'd like to see actually a little bit less of the, thank you, LeBron, no matter what. First and foremost, you should be rooting for him to be back here. Second of all, if he's not back here, you got to be rooting for the best possible deal in return to combine with that number 8 draft pick, whether it be Ingram, whether it be Fultz, whatever. You got to get back something for LeBron to rebuild for the future.
Rick, you're the best, my friend. Great stuff from Cleveland. Good luck to you. Thanks for chiming in, man. We'll catch up with you soon.
Always an honor and a pleasure, Joe. Thank you.
All right. Thanks, Rick. Rick Morris from the FDH Lounge in Cleveland. He does a national show, and he always has good information about LeBron.